Hi, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on where you're calling in from today. Thanks for joining us for today's session, Understanding the Rules of Persuasion. This is a topic that is not part of our normal automation, AI, digital transformation kind of tech track. It's more under the category of professional development, which we want to do more and more here. But a familiar face, Carlos Alvarenga, who has been my co-host on the Digital Leader Show for almost a year and a half now. Just finished his writing his book, The Rules of Persuasion, and so we thought it'd be great to do more of a professional development topic for you all today on a topic that I think is, relevant to any person, not, any within an organization, especially. But if you're in the corporate world, if you're in sales, marketing, communications, definitely. But even if you're not, right? Even if you have to just deal with people every day, which post-COVID, we're back to dealing with people every day. Really, really important topic. And I've read the book and talked to Carlos about it. I think you'll find this sort of master class very worthwhile. Before we jump in, quick introduction on us. If you've never attended one of our events, ERPA AI is a professional association focused on automation and artificial intelligence. We've got over 130,000 members worldwide, all coming to us for education, networking, and advice in these areas. We've also got a sister organization, the Digital Enterprise Institute, which covers kind of everything else from a enterprise transformation standpoint. So if there's anything we can do to ever help you in your journey, either as an individual, a career, or as an organization, do let us know. We have a variety of different programs around coaching, training, free industry briefings, and sales and marketing services as well. So Carlos, I'll let Carlos kind of give you the most recent update on what he's doing. But he's an independent researcher, an author, a coach. He's the founder of the Persuasion Lab. He's co-director of narrative and storytelling at the Museum Experience Lab at Fowler, UCLA. Prior to this role, he was executive director at World 50, EY, Accenture, adjunct professor at the Smith School of Business at the University of Maryland. And I don't think he sleeps. I think he's figured out how to do this 3 hours a day. Carlos, welcome back, buddy.
I see you back, Dan. Good to be with the record. Thank you for having me.
So tell me, I think I interviewed you, and we talked a little bit on the Digital Leaders Show podcast over several weeks. But I think I interviewed you maybe a year ago when you were putting the final touches on the book. And before you jump in, just curious as to how you see the feedback so far.
Happy to say the feedback has been overwhelmingly positive, which is nice to know when you spend 3 years researching and writing and then publishing a book. You're always nervous about how is it going to be received. And I've had people call me and say, I never finish a business book. This is the first one I'm going to read twice. I bought four copies for colleagues of mine. So happy to say the early reviews have been really positive, which is nice to hear.
And I'm, for me, I'm a visual learner. I like conversational learning, and this. So as much as I love the book, I'm really excited to kind of hear the masterclass version, and I think it's gonna excite me to go back into the book. But for those of you who haven't read the book, this is a great primer. For those of you who have, it'll kind of get your mind going, right, Carlos?
Yeah, a little bit of the talk track behind what you read in the book is what I hope to cover today. It's a lot of material in the book, so obviously today we're going to look at it. One of the elements, which is this thing called the periodic table of persuasion and what persuasion is, and I'll highlight that and we'll look at some examples from a few movies that I think everybody knows and kind of see it at work. And I'll start off with an actual real-world case study in a moment.
Yeah, real world use cases are the bread and butter of the stuff we do. So, quick housekeeping. We are going to do Q&A at the end. So, if you have any questions for Carlos, go ahead and send them in through the GoToWebinar control panel. We'll also send out a link to the book and the slides to all the attendees and the recording to all the attendees after the fact. Carlos, over to you, buddy.
Okay, if I can just get presenter control, take it from there. Let's see here. Okay, making sure you can see my slides, Dan.
Yep.
All right, so I'm going to, first of all, thank you to everyone who's taking time out of your busy day. I know to hear the presentation today. I hope you'll find it interesting and valuable. So I'm going to start right away with a real-world case study. This is someone who came to me a while back and someone I'd known for a while. He had become chief commercial officer at an industrial American company. the company was acquired by a private equity firm, and the private equity firm brought in a new CEO who had been a chief commercial officer in the past. So he felt he really knew sales and how to run a sales organization. The PE firm, as you can imagine, put a tremendous amount of pressure on the CEO, who then put a tremendous amount of pressure on my client to increase sales in 2022. My client told his new boss, listen, the company has dominant market share in all our markets, right? That's why we're doing so well. Client budgets in our industry are set a year in advance. And it's the really thing we should do is start thinking about next year, because we're selling a year in advance. You know, 22 is sort of done, let it run its course. And that should be the approach we take. The CEO was not persuaded. And in fact, he was so unpersuaded that he changed the meeting schedule from a monthly cadence to a weekly cadence and began to review every single account, not just major, but every single account in great detail. My client was exasperated. He felt he was being micromanaged. He was dispirited. It had gotten to the point when I talked to him that he said, I'm at this moment ready to walk into C's office, tell him he doesn't get the industry, doesn't get me, and I'm going to hand in my resignation. So I'm going to start with this situation, ask you, what would you have advised? What would you have, how would you have analyzed what's happening at this moment? And what would you have told this person to do? Now, hold that thought, and then we'll come back to it at the end of the presentation. So let's get into the content of the book, right? And I'll start by asking you a really interesting question. Whenever I coach anyone, the first thing we discuss is, what is persuasion? It's a word we think about or use every day. We don't always think about it, actually. It's something which is part of every single job I've ever seen. It's in our personal life. It's in our professional life. But one of the interesting things is that we usually don't study it. Most people don't take persuasion classes in undergraduate or business school. It isn't taught. And so we just kind of go through life with some sense of what it is, which is why when I ask the question, what is persuasion? I will get a whole variety of answers, right? Somebody agrees with me, something you're born with or not. It's a kind of soft skill. Nobody knows, right? It's hidden manipulation, getting someone to do what they don't want to do. It depends. And so this is problem number one, that it's very hard to be good at something when you can't define what it is. And so the work that I do and the basis of the book is an Aristotelian. What does that mean? It means it goes back to a philosopher named Aristotle, who wrote a book called The Rhetoric. And in the book, he explained his view of what persuasion is. And I think that for most people, this is still the best way to think about this word. And he says in the book, look, persuasion is a demonstration that something is true or seems to be true, period. This is a very simple and very complete definition, which I think is correct. When you show someone that something is true or seems to be true, persuasion takes place, right? Persuasion for Aristotle was a word that we don't have an English counterpart for. It's called the technique. So technique was a technical art, a technical craft, and it required both talent and technique. For him, there were two kinds of persuasion. There was persuasion of knowing something to be completely true, which he called science, and persuasion of belief, which he called opinion. Right, we're concerned today with opinion, the second kind. An important implication of his definition is that people don't persuade truth, but the appearance of truth persuades. Persuasion is not influence in this structure, right? You may be influenced by the life of Mahatma Gandhi, but you're not persuaded by him unless you read his writings or listen to his words. So persuasion happens in one-to-one contact. It requires interaction. Influence can happen at a distance. So when we think about persuasion, we're talking about a communicator interacting with his or her audience. Okay. So in his book, Aristotle says, listen, it doesn't matter what time or place, if humans are communicating with other humans, there are three things that persuade. And I call these modes. And the modes are the character of the speaker, who is speaking, what is speaking, what institution, what person, what arguments are being presented, and how is the emotional response of the listener? What emotion does the listener feel when the message is being delivered? You may have read an article on LinkedIn or a bunch of other places that use this term ethos, logos, and pathos. It's very common. But what I find is that although people use these words in articles and in general conversation, they never ask a really interesting question, which is, okay, Aristotle, that's great, but what do you mean by each one? And how do they really work? This is the question I kind of became obsessed with. Of what exactly is character? What exactly is argument? And what exactly is emotion in this structure, right? And how does persuasion actually happen? So to answer this question, I wrote my book. So the book is trying to expand on what he says and then explain it with examples from, you know, our modern time. And what I say in the book is that there is each of these modes is made up of seven what I call elements. So if you think about character, your character, my character, the character of a company like Apple, the character organization, it has seven elements that make up what character is. So the first one is associations, which is what the audience thinks or knows about you. Categories, which are the things that you apply to yourself, like what school you went to, what clubs you belong to, what political party you're a member of. Your history, what have you done in the past? The language you use, the way in which you speak to people. The origin, where do you come from? Your status relative to the audience, and the style you use in delivering your message. So these are the seven elements that make up the character part in that ethos, logos, pathos trilogy. The second one is argument. So argument has also seven components in my book, right? There's antecedents of what has happened in the past, right? In our company, we never do this, or we've always had a tradition of doing blank, right? That's antecedent, right? Authorities, the CEO told me about this. I read it in a science journal. A professor said this was correct. Evidence, what people show you as they're trying to persuade you. Interrogation, which is question and answer of a witness or your opponent, right? Or someone who doesn't agree with you. The logic you present, how you structure the presentation of all the pieces of your persuasion strategy. Laws and standards, right? Policies, these kinds of things, these written and unwritten codes that guide a society. And then witnesses, somebody you bring in to say something on behalf of your argument, right? These elements are combined and recombined in what I call formulation. So they're really used individually. They're usually put together in different formulas, which we'll look at more in detail in a minute. Lastly here, we see that emotion is also broken up into seven pieces, right? So we can think of emotions that are contemplative, right? These are the emotions that make you stop, pause, think, right? When you say, consider our history, I'm asking you to slow your brain down and to process something that I believe will make you agree with me. Exploitative, which are emotions that get you to do something. Inspirational, emotions that get you to want something, right? Mystical, emotions you feel, but you can't quite explain. They don't have a label. It's just something that I felt when I was in the presence of this person or at this event or in this moment in my life. I can't put a finger on it, right? I can't label it, but I know something is real. Negative, anger, hatred, the things that stir up negative reactions. Positive, the opposite, happiness, joy. And then sacred, emotions that are tied to religion in some way, right? Most formulations are old. They've been around for a long time. But every once in a while, I come across ones, and we come across ones that are new. The most important thing I say in the book is the next slide. And that is, the best way, I think, to think about persuasion is as chemistry with words. A communicator takes these 21 elements, right? And I call this the pyridoxal persuasion, and combines them in various formulas that we then experience as an audience. And if it's done correctly, if it's done with skill, like any good chemist, right, the formulas have power and we are persuaded. If the formula is either mixed incorrectly or delivered incorrectly or in the wrong quantity, right, they can go from being ineffective to, in some cases, as I explained in the book, actually poisoning us to believe things that are wrong or corrupt or even evil. In the cases we've seen over history. So this is really the most important to me image of the book, which is the sense of when we think about persuasion, it is not a soft skill, it is not undefined, it is not something that you're just born with. It is a chemistry with language. And we can look at how these formulations, and I do in the book, I think there are almost 40 QR codes that take you to videos on YouTube where I explain each of these elements and how each one is working in a song, a movie, a piece of literature, a political speech, eulogy, and we'll do a little bit of that just now. So let's start by looking at how these formulations actually get used by a communicator. And we'll start with character. So character is, again, who is talking to me? What is talking to me? So in character, it's very important because it establishes predisposition. What does that mean? It means that a person's character will draw you towards them or will push you away from them. And we've all experienced this, that as somebody speaks, we either kind of, I don't like what this person is saying, which means I don't like them, or, you know, it's a very nice person, let me hear what she has to say, right? It forms connections, associations, it brings us forward or pushes us away, and it supports or weakens what someone is saying. When character fails, because it does, and we've all seen this happen, right? It creates apathy at best and hatred at worst. So let's look at an example of this formulation idea at work. I'm going to show you a video clip from a movie. In this movie, the formulation you're about to see, it's only 90 seconds long, it's built from associations, categories, history, status, and style. These are the elements at work in what we're about to see, which is the opening scene of a movie called Patton. This is a movie made by Franklin Schaffner, came out at the height of the Vietnam War. And Patton wanted to make, Schaffner wanted to make a statement about Patton and about war and a lot of complex issues around leadership. And he begins the movie with a very famous scene in which we see Patton and we are asked to absorb the character who is the main agent of this movie. So I'm going to switch to the video and let's just watch and think about all the information that you're being given about the character of Patton in this first minute. Very famous opening. Now, let's look at what we just saw. Almost every piece of character is evident in this first 90 or so seconds. We're given associations. He's a military man, which makes him a warrior, a savior, a killer. He's a history of being a hero. He's got medals from America. He's medals from other countries. He's a fighter. He's won battles. He's won wars. He's of high status. He's a four-star general. If you notice carefully, at one point you see a Pearl Handle revolver with his initials on it. Patton was the wealthiest officer in the American Army when he served. He came from a wealthy family. So he's a man of high status, right? In his categories, you see American, soldier. He's a West Pointer. He comes from the United States. We see this immense flag behind him, which shows a patriot, someone who is associating himself with the nation of the United States. And then he has a remarkable style. He wears riding gear, which is not typical army uniform, which shows someone who has the power to dress any way he wants, pretty much, and who is a horseman, right, which is typically associated, again, with someone of high status. His hands are manicured, his fingernails. It's someone who cares about the way he looks. He's an egotistic man, he's vain, and he marches to his own cadence, right? He carries a riding crop. So in all these pieces of information that we're given, Schaffner, the director, is pushing us to or pushing us away from this character, right? If you're pushed towards, you are inclined to take what he's about to say, the famous speech, and believe it, be persuaded by it. If you're not, you're pushed away from it. But this opening scene, which originally the legend is that Patton didn't, I mean, the character, Jesse Scott, didn't want to shoot, which then became the iconic moment of the film. We see the impact, right, that just the presentation of the speaker has on us before one word has been said. As I mentioned, the second mode at work is argument. Argument are all the things that we bring, facts, statistics, logic. Like I said, argument is important for many reasons. It establishes facts, it presents evidence, it creates proofs, it pushes back on emotion. Right? We talk about this sort of left brain, right brain, or emotion versus logic. When argument fails, it creates confusion, however, and chaos at worst. And we probably, most of us have been in a room when someone tried to present a complex argument and we just couldn't follow, or we got lost, or the numbers didn't add up. And so argument, funny enough, in argument is overused for the most part, especially in professional settings. Most professional people tend to put all of the weight of persuasion on argument, which is problematic because argument is the hardest to get right, and it's the least effective by human nature. But let's look at an example of argument that we don't always think of as argument, and that is interrogation. We're gonna look at a movie clip which uses this formulation. And here we have mostly argument, interrogation, laws and standards, logic, and a little bit of emotion, well, not a little bit, I'd say a good amount of emotion thrown in as well, but mostly argument. And it's a scene in which Tom Cruise plays a young lawyer who is putting Jack Nicholson on trial for having ordered the attack of a young Marine that resulted in the Marine's death. And so as the trial has moved along, Cruise, who's Lieutenant Caffey in the movie, has no evidence, has no proof. His witnesses aren't doing so well. And so he's really done. He only has one witness he can call, who is Nicholson. And there is nothing left for him to do to win his case other than to persuade Jack Nicholson to admit he ordered what he calls the code red, the order that results in the death of this Private Santiago. So he must somehow persuade this colonel, someone who is much, much higher than him in the hierarchy of the military, and risk his career to get this man to admit what he did. So now let's watch a little clip from the moment in which he, Tom Cruise, decides, I'm going to try a series of questions and statements that are going to persuade the colonel to admit that he ordered this code red.
You, Colonel. You snotty little bastard.
Your Honor, I'd like to ask for a recess.
I'd like an answer to the question, Judge.
The court will wait for an answer.
If Lieutenant Kendrick gave an order that Santiago wasn't to be touched, why did he have to be transferred? Lieutenant Kendrick ordered the code red, didn't he? Because that's what you told Lieutenant Kendrick to do.
Object! What do you want, Ben? You cut these guys loose!
Your Honor, you
walked inside the body transfer!
Your Honor, you doctored the logbook!
Damn it, Captain!
Of course you doctored yourself, didn't you?
Colonel Jessup, did you order the code red?
You don't have to answer that question.
I'll answer the question. You want answers?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
As we know, if you've seen the movie, what happens next is that the colonel does, in fact, confess to having given the code red. In fact, he wants to confess. And the way that Andrew Ross Sorkin, who wrote originally a play and then the screenplay, does it is in this three-part formulation. First of all, he has Cruise slash Caffey highlight the flawed logic to the court. If Lieutenant Kendrick gave an order that Santiago wasn't to be touched, why did he have to be transferred from the base? So what had happened was that they were getting ready to move him, but the logic of it doesn't make any sense. If the private were safe, he didn't need to be transferred from Guantanamo Bay, which is where this event took place. So first is to highlight the flawed logic. Then Caffey says, I'm going to reverse our status, right? I'm going to be a lieutenant claiming that I'm entitled to answers from a colonel. It's an aggravating style of delivery. He ramps up negative emotions. Eventually, the colonel calls him this fine little bastard. So he's agitating the person he's interrogating. And then he, at the end, pushes and says, he violates the standards of the court and says, I want the truth, right? The famous scene, you can't handle the truth, is Nicholson's response. It is a remarkable example of someone who has no other element, no witnesses, no data, no statistics, just in this back and forth, which lasts about 3 or 4 minutes in this film. Cruz is able to get the person who is across from him to admit, and he persuades him through this strategy to admit that he ordered the code red. Now let's look at the last one, which is emotion. Emotion, as I mentioned, are the things that the person feels or an audience feels as you're speaking. And emotion is important. It validates character. It inspires thought or action. It seems to prove, emotion doesn't prove, but it seems to prove. The famous gut feel of when someone's speaking to us is the seeming to prove phenomenon. And it counters argument, right? Oftentimes, people are presented with facts and they respond with an emotional statement, which counters the logic or the data. When emotion fails, it creates sentimentality, which is emotion that feels a little bit fake, not really real, or antipathy, which is extreme negative reaction against the speaker. We'll look at another film clip here, or actually it's a TV clip. And this is a phenomenal scene. And in this scene, what you're gonna see is the use of emotion, which uses contemplative emotion, mystical emotion, but also there's a very subtle call to authority, which you see if you can pick up as you watch the clip. And the clip is from a TV show called Mad Men. And it's my favorite scene from the entire series, and it's called the carousel scene. And in this scene, just to set it up for you, what's happening is that Don Draper, who's the main character, is an advertising executive. And he has been asked to make a pitch to Kodak, to convince Kodak to have his agency do the ad campaign for the new slide projector, which is kind of a wheel, was when it was first invented. And so his pitch is what we'll see, just a little bit of it, in which he says to the Kodak people why they should hire his agency to run their campaign.
My first job, I was in-house at a fur company with this old pro copywriter, Greek, named Teddy. And Teddy told me the most important idea in advertising is new. It creates an itch. You simply put your product in there as a kind of online lotion. But he also talked about a deeper bond with the product. Nostalgia. It's delicate, but potent. Sweetheart. Teddy told me that in Greek, nostalgia literally means the pain from an old wound. It's a twinge in your heart, far more powerful than memory alone. This device isn't a spaceship. It's a time machine. Goes backwards, forwards. It takes us to a place where we ache to go again. It's not called the wheel. It's called the carousel. Let's just travel the way a child travels. Around and around, back home again. A place where we know we are loved. Thank you. Good luck at your next meeting.
I like the end of the scene. Good luck at your next meeting. They knew they had the client. They knew they'd won the pitch, right? The really almost 99.9% emotional formulation, which you see demonstrated in that clip, right, is a remarkable scene. And if you picked up at the beginning, the attendant people, that when he says an old pro copywriter, a Greek named Teddy, that's his call to authority, right? It's subtle but persuasive touch. And I think this scene really exemplifies when you're using, you know, the emotional reaction of the audience, which is something which is rare in business. For example, you don't really see it used very much. I think people are afraid to do it, but it can be an incredibly powerful thing, as we see there, even in a commercial setting, which really nobody expected. So we've talked about each of these three modes. I want to use an example of putting them all together before we wrap up. And that is, at the highest level, when great communicators do what they do, they're usually working with some combination of all three elements at the same time, right? They've got a little bit of character, some argument, some emotion. And when somebody does a great job of putting them all together, the results can be remarkable. And the one I want to show you and talk about, and I talk about it in the book, is one that we've probably all seen, and that is just do it. So this is a slogan that was invented by a gentleman named Dad Wheaton of the firm Wheaton & Kennedy in 1988. He had the Nike account, his firm did, Wheaton & Kennedy, and they were doing a lot of advertising, a lot of different formats, a lot of different ways. And Wheaton was convinced that they needed a tagline that would be shown on every ad, on every commercial, that in the minds of the audience would unite all the various images, all the various athletes, the various settings, with one idea, which they didn't have. Nobody thought they needed it except for Wheaton. And he was watching, the story goes that, or he tells the story that he was watching the execution of a man named Gary Gilmore. And when Gilmore was being taken to his execution, he was asked, "Do you have any last words?" And Gilmore said, "Let's do it." Wheaton said, "I just got to change one word from let's to just, and that's the slogan." So he came into Nike. Nike hated it. But because Wheaton was such a successful advertiser, his character persuaded Phil Knight and the Nike team to accept and run the ad. Of course, today, many years later, in pretty much every argument or article you read about advertising, it is considered the greatest tagline of all time. What's important to understand is why. Why is Just Do It, which has been around for, I guess, now 50 years, why was it so great then, and what is so great now? Right. And I argue in the book that it's great because it has all three modes at work. First of all, it is an argument. It's actually technically a counter argument. So you might have reasons why you don't want to work out. Just Do It says, I understand all that. I don't care, or that's not good enough. You should just do it. That is the response to all the reasons why someone doesn't exercise. Right. So there is a logical response that comes in this statement. There's a statement of character, which is very profound. The person who is disciplined, the person who is who has a strong character, that doesn't let that they're tired or it's late or it's early or they don't feel like it get in the way. They just do it. All right, what kind of person are you? Are you the person who skips, right, something because it's difficult? Or are you the kind of person who sticks with it and does what has to be done? And then lastly, there's an emotional component to it, right? There is this, in the advertising you see for Nike, there's never been an ad in Nike that says why trust is great. It's always about how you feel, the emotional sense of triumph, even a failure, right, of victory. And so Nike has built a brand on an emotional response to exercise without ever once, as far as I know, making logical arguments on behalf of exercising or even its products for the most part. It's often this sense of character and emotion. And if you've seen the ads, and even go back to the original Nike ad that had the slogan at the first time called the Stack ad, it was always built on feeling good about working out. And so the reason this is so powerful, and when we see things like this, the Gettysburg Address, right, very memorable moments of communication, what you're usually going to find is a combination of fusion of all three of these modes at work. Unfortunately, though, as I said earlier, right? If we think of persuasion as chemistry, then chemistry can be used to make medicine, but it can also be used to make poison. And so the same way in which a great communicator convinces us to buy a product or to do great things, somebody can come along and use the same techniques, right, for evil or fraudulent purposes. And I'm going to show you one clip of that at work. And in this complex person, right, what we see is this really amazing fusion of character, argument, and emotion for what ends up becoming a really negative example of the power of persuasion at work.
Just talk about all the innovations along the way.
And for those of you who don't recognize this young woman, it is Elizabeth Holmes, the founder and CEO of a biotech company called Theranos, which raised something like $700 million fraudulently from investors. And she was convicted recently of fraud and is going to serve an 11-year sentence for her role in what happened at Theranos.
So our belief fundamentally is that the answer to our challenges in healthcare lies in engaging and empowering the individual. And if we can connect with people so that they begin to understand that they have this basic human right to get access to information about their body that can change their life, we can begin to engage people in the process of finding some of this information out in time to do something about it. So we have exactly designed an end-to-end solution, which is geared toward being able to get people engaged, because engagement is the first step to knowledge, which then often can facilitate behavior change.
So you see in this example, someone who's incredibly adept at using all of these things that we've been talking about to convince an audience that they should invest in her company, right? We have her very famous use of the black turtleneck, right? She sort of modeled herself after Steve Jobs and did nothing to dissuade anyone from comparing her or aligning her to Jobs. She wanted to be seen in that way, and it was an intentional strategy. She talked about how she slept in the office. She was devoted to the company. She had left college at Stanford to found this company because she was so driven by this vision, again, a la Jobs. And so you have in this character she created of the founder, right, a very Jobs-like fusion of these various elements, right? In her arguments, they're very weak. There's never any logic. There are never any proofs. The statistics are always sort of fake, right? So she doesn't rely on this. She talks a little bit about what's come in the past, but for the most part, she stays away from this. And then we have emotion, right? There's talk of this mystical sense of healing the world, of feeling bad that somebody dies because they didn't get tested, and then feeling good because Theranos has a new way of doing things. And then she constantly uses, if you watch the videos of her, which I have lots of them, this sense of trying to inspire people, especially her own team, to follow her sort of down this road. So as we think about Theranos, as we think about Nike, as we think about other examples, right, a point that I make in the book is that these formulations, right, can be created for good or for evil. So one more slide before we wrap up, and that is one of the things that I wanted to do in the book that I hadn't seen anybody else do is to walk me through what exactly happens when someone is persuaded. We use the word a lot, but what does it really mean? Like, what exactly is the step-by-step process? And I'll recap here the section in the chapter in the book that talks about this phenomenon, right? And what happens, I argue, is this. We all sort of walk around in what I call this pre-audience state. We are not really paying attention. We may be going to work or taking a train. We're not engaging with messages, but we know that they're there. Suddenly a message captures our attention. We notice an ad in a magazine or a billboard or someone says something to us, right? And the first thing is that we acknowledge it. We say, okay, I understand that someone's trying to communicate something to me. The next question is, or next step is engagement. We decide to listen, to read, to engage with what's being said to us. As we do, the message creates energy. If we like it, we feed energy to it as well, right? And eventually that energy reaches a point where the message becomes actualized. That moment where the claim, take a vacation in the Caribbean, becomes real in our mind. And we go, you know what? I need to go to the Caribbean for my next vacation. That is when persuasion occurs. It is the release of enough energy by the message, the communicator, and the audience that the claim that is being presented, right, or the idea that is being presented comes to life. And that is when persuasion occurs. The last step is called acceptance, which means that, as we know, you might agree to something for a day and then wake up the next day and not agree anymore. To the degree that a message is accepted and kept, right, that becomes the last step in the process. And so there are things that are done after the persuasion occurs to get someone to hold on to that idea. And so this is the step, and I go through some more detail in the book. When we think about our audience, right, we want to first have them acknowledge us. Two, we want them to engage with us, right? Bring energy to our message such that it brings our ideas to life, and then hopefully they accept it and hold on to that in the future. So to wrap up, right, we should think about persuasion not as a soft skill, as an amorphous thing, or some innate skill that you're either born with and you're not. It is a technique. It's a technical art that operates by specific rules, right, which Aristotle put in his book, and I expand and illustrate in my book. Persuasion is a demonstration something is true or seems to be true. Each persuasion mode has 7 elements, and together they make up what I call the periodic table of persuasion. And every message I've ever looked at, and I've looked at them across time, place, centuries in my book, you can see this formulations at work. Persuasion occurs when a skilled communicator creates powerful formulas that bring truth to life in the mind of the audience. Think of persuasion as chemistry with words, which can be used for good and evil. Great persuasion, to me, the foundational skill set for success in selling, negotiating, collaborating, advertising, advocating, and pretty much all forms of human communication. We are trying to get someone to agree with us or to understand or see things the way we see them. Persuasion can be learned, even mastered with the right knowledge, training, and practice. It's like playing the piano. It's a skill set, and there are ways of understanding this, which I present in the book. And if you take those ideas and put them to work, everybody, or just about everybody, I would say, can get better at it. And if you have an innate talent for this and you bring technique to it, the way in which you improve can be significantly better. I mean, dramatic changes in because you've taken your talent and you've given it rules and methods to work with. Now, before I wrap up, let's go back to the slide that I presented at the beginning. So like I said, this was a real story, right? So we have this CEO who's being micromanaged by his new CEO and is being put under tremendous pressure to sell. Keep in mind that the CEO is literally ready to walk in and resign, right? So what was my advice? My advice was to think that it was probably likely that the CEO was micromanaging because the CEO, who was a former sales executive, thought that my client had, quote unquote, given up on the year, right? It was still early, still Q1, and he felt that his chief salesperson, right, was already thinking too far down the road. The CEO, under intense board pressure, needed to make sure that if there was any chance to change the outcome of 22 for the better, that his CCO was making every effort to do so. My advice was, I need you to go to the CEO and I want you to meet twice a week, not every week, but twice a week, and to present urgent and out of the box ideas to improve the outcome of 2022. My theory was that once the CEO understood that my client's obsession with sales was equal or higher to than the CEO, that he would relax and stop micromanaging. In other words, the reason the CEO was so on top of my client is that all he needed to know was that my client cared more about the numbers than he did. My advice was persuade him through character and emotion that you are even more committed to maximizing sales than he is. My client did as advised, and the CEO reacted exactly as predicted. After a few weeks, he calmed down, agreed that monthly meetings were fine, and eventually pulled the CCO aside to ask him to think about the company strategy in 2023. So exactly what he had tried to get in the beginning. he got not by arguing or about confrontation, but by simply understanding what is the audience was saying to him, and then developing a formulation that would persuade him to accept the approach that the CCO wanted. So as we think about this case study, and there are others that I cover in the book, really it's about applying, right, the rules that you learn, and to think about how these different formulations work in real life, and then put into work. It's practice, but they can be learned and they can be put to use. And just to wrap up that, what I'm giving today is really a quick summary of what's in the book. Obviously the book has the entire story. And if anyone is interested in knowing more, I have set up an online community called persuasionlab.org. We meet twice a week to look at different case studies and workshops and ideas from the book. And anyone is welcome to join if you'd like to continue conversation. So let me go ahead and stop screen sharing and turn it back to you, Dan. Thank you.
Carlos, that was great. And it makes me think of the fact that I need to hire you myself, because I had a very similar situation recently to the one you just described. I was wondering if it was me. But no, really good presentation. You know, we've talked about a lot of these things conceptually, but really all kind of motivating, with the exception of you telling me that the Just Do It campaign is 50 years old, and now I feel ancient. That was a really motivating. So I have a bunch of questions, and for anybody watching, please send your questions in now. We've got maybe 10, 15 minutes to get to some Q&A, and whatever we don't get to, I'm sure Carlos would be willing to follow up with people or continue the conversation on the Persuasion Lab forum. But you know, one of the things that I always get, and I've been in sales and marketing my whole life, Carlos, as you know, right, is that persuasion often has a negative connotation because it's related in a lot of people's minds to sales, which also in some people's minds has a negative connotation. So is persuasion sales? Is it a subcategory? And do you why has it had that negative connotation?
Well, I say we had medicine long before we had chemistry, right, Dan? And so I think of sales as medicine and persuasion as chemistry, right? Sales, great salespeople and books about sales that are really good, what they do is they apply these concepts, although they didn't know what they were, right? But they're innately putting these things to work, just like good books on a training on negotiation, for example. It's another example where that is the medicine, the medicinal application of the ideas that are covered in the book. So I think that great salespeople know a lot of these things kind of innately, and they put them to work. My sense is that one reason why sales-ish sort of conversations, that a lot of books about sales and persuasion and sales aren't really about persuasion at all. They're about manipulation, right? Yeah. They're about using what I would call tricks, psychological tricks, like the Cialdini book, for example. If you read it, everybody, it's not a book about persuasion. It's a book about human reactions that are sometimes unconscious or subconscious, and how to manipulate those to get someone to buy something. I think if you persuade someone and you do it correctly, most people are okay with that and are pretty happy, right? There are lots of things that I bought that I was happy somebody sold it to me. So I think the question is of, are you persuading? And by the way, because there's manipulation, there's persuasion, there's coercion. And this is the real issue in business, because if you think you've persuaded, but you've actually coerced, then you've got a very fragile leadership position. And I tell clients sometimes, if you walk out the door tomorrow, does your initiative or big idea walk with you? If it does, be careful, because you may think you've persuaded when you've actually coerced.
Yeah, I read a sales strategy book once. It was actually written by the guy, Wolf of Wall Street guy, Jordan Belfort. And at the beginning, he basically makes you sign an agreement that you're going to use the techniques for good and not evil, because he said, hey, I've used this for evil, you know, for manipulation and stuff. But, you know, you actually got to believe that you're helping people and do it for the right reasons. And I always thought that was interesting.
Someone is not to manipulate, right? It is to convince them that something that you believe is true is also true from their perspective.
Is there, you know, we've all worked in corporate environments where there's people that are more difficult to work with than others. Is there such thing as a person who's just not persuadable?
Yeah, if someone no longer functions rationally, right, or is they enter a term that this guy Paul Starr has coined called entrenchment, right? It means that you no longer are open to new ideas, new anything, right? You've locked the rhetorical door, right? And so once somebody locks the persuasion door, yeah, they refuse to engage, right? Go back to that four-step process. They refuse. They might acknowledge, but they won't engage. And persuasion requires engagement, right? And so, and this is the point I make about sometimes people who come to speak on university campuses, just because I engage with you doesn't mean that I'm persuaded by you, right? So one of the best arguments, I think, for free speech, right, on campuses is just engagement isn't acceptance. It's not persuasion. It's just listening to what someone has to say. And then you can have the right to disagree, right? So, but to answer your question, when somebody will not engage at all, then, you know, it's like somebody has one of those NBC suits, right? So that the virus won't contaminate them, right? They put this, they covered themselves to such extent that they refuse to let anything get through.
I think that's so true. I love that that engagement doesn't necessarily mean persuasion. I mean, and we've all gotten off a call where we think, you know, it was a good conversation and we've convinced somebody and then nothing happens. Heck, my wife says that to me all the time. I said, I thought we talked about this. She goes, we did. I didn't agree with you though, right?
Sure.
So we have a question here from Agakan. He wants to know, so he's a sales rep within a marketing technology company. He's wondering if there's kind of some quick tips, Carlos, that can help him be more persuasive in the sales process.
I think the most important thing is to think about the different pieces of the message. Just think about it in a very basic sense, right? What is my story bringing to the conversation? What does the audience know about me? And is there anything that if they knew about me would make the audience more likely to believe me, which is often left out? This is really common. People have been told you shouldn't be part of the message, whatever, and I think that's wrong. Aristotle says this is the most important of the three modes, and I agree. So what does my own life story or my own character bring? The argument, use just enough, less is more. When in doubt, reduce it, right? Because people have a hard time following this. So limit that whenever you can. And then think about what is somebody feeling as I speak? What is the emotional reaction? Are they going to feel fear, happiness, anxiety? And if that emotion is not being addressed, then try, if you can, to recognize, acknowledge the fact that there are often emotions involved, especially in big buying decisions, hiring an ex-consultant, committing to a two-year project with a consulting company is an emotional decision for many clients, and acknowledging that is important. So I'd say, take a step back, use this framework and say, if I look at my pitch, my proposal, my RFP response, my presentation for the big, you know, closing meeting for orals, whatever the situation may be, how are these three factors at work? And if you don't know what they are, then take a moment to think about them and see if you can't refine those using some of the things we talked about today.
Yeah, interesting. And you know, you and I on the podcast had a guest a while back that was an expert in storytelling that you had brought into the show. And so that relates, right? I think about some of the things that, you know, especially as technologists where we have to explain, not even just sell, but explain really complicated technology. And it's often the story of what, maybe why we created that technology or what problem we were trying to address or whatever the storyline is that makes people, I guess, connect to it is what you'd say.
Right, because story is like the delivery mechanism, right? Like they have a pill or a capsule. So is it a PowerPoint deck? Is it, I'm going to tell you a story over dinner? So that's how the chemistry is delivered, right? And storytelling is a very useful delivery mechanism when somebody learns how to tell good stories and how to shape good stories, right? And every story is changed over time, right? I always say it's XY axis. So it's what changes over how much time. And I think if you think about once the formula is made and you say, I'm going to deliver it to my audience in a story, then just making sure the story does everything that you want it to do is the key thing.
So, you know, there's always people that we see, you know, in media or even in our own lives that just seem, Carlos, like they're like they're naturals, like they were born with the ability to be charismatic and do these things. Is that real, or is that just somebody who behind the scenes has learned this? Are people actually born with it? And if not, can it? I think you said it can be taught. Will you ever be as good as someone who's kind of born with it?
Look, it's like music, right? Of course, there are people who play the piano when they're five, hadn't taken a certain lesson, right? Mozart, the famous example. So he was composing about that age. And so, yeah, there are here and there people who are just innately talented in this. But that's a very small number. For the most part, right, are people who have worked hard and studied this and practice it. And even people who seem like it's just innate talent, really, if you look behind the scenes, it's years and years of practice in many cases. So, yes, there is a talent component, but my experience coaching people for years has been that everybody I've coached has gotten better, some more than others. But once you have the technique, then whatever talent you do have gets maximized.
Why you spend a lot of time, you come from education, Carlos, why is this not taught? I mean, I feel like this is one of those things where, you know, people not only don't learn this in school, but they don't learn this until later in their careers, if at all.
Well, I talk about this in the book, in the chapter on sort of the dark side, right? And I say, I think what happened was that after World War II, with what happened in Nazi Germany and their use of persuasion to commit, right, one of the great tragedies of human history, that the sense was we're better off just not sharing this with people. Right, it's too much of a dangerous thing, and so little by little, the Aristotelian framework of persuasion, which I think is the right one, fell off the educational agenda, and eventually became a subject for specialists and scholars. And so there were people who I know in that community who didn't want me to write this book, and that was, look, this is best left on the shelf, right, for the professionals to deal with. But my argument, my counter argument is, just because you don't teach chemistry, that doesn't mean that it stops working. So I had this other reason writing the book, which was to make people aware that these formulas exist and that they're sometimes used by terrible people to persuade us of terrible things. And the best way to be, you know, immunized for this is to understand how these rules operate.
Other than reading the book, Carlos, and getting involved in your community, what's a good starting point? I find people often attend things like this and they get interested and they kind of go back to work because it seems like a big endeavor to accomplish, right? Is there kind of a natural on-ramp or starting point where someone can get into this and maybe get some near-term benefits?
I go back to just taking apart a message, whether it's yours or someone else's, in these three categories. Right. And when I coach people, I have them do a persuasion journal, which is keep track of what you see just mentally in your mind. If you see a commercial, someone speaking on TV, me, you, this webinar, right? What elements, there were elements of emotion in this presentation, right? The clip from Mad Men, there was character, my bio at the start, right? There's argument, things that I've shown you and said. And so as you think about everything around you, you just become a critic and of your own messages and just take it back and say, well, if it worked, why did it work? If it didn't work, why did it not work? And making this simple three box structure, right, a part of how you think about messaging is a really easy, I think, and effective first step. If I were coaching somebody, this is what we do anyway. And that's where it all begins. Everything else is just a refinement of that, right? The 21 elements, all that, that's just making more detail of what is really a very powerful and very simple framework for looking at messages.
Carlos, tell us the link one more time, the Persuasion Lab.
www.persuasionlab.org.
And we'll send that out to all the attendees afterwards as well with the recording and a link to the book. Carlos, thank you so much, buddy. It was great to do this with you again and very valuable. I appreciate the time. I know our members do as well.
Thanks to everyone for listening. Thank you.
Have a good week, everybody. Take care.